Tragedy does not discriminate, death does not pardon, but takes whomever it pleases, most times giving no satisfactory reasons. Unfortunately, this happy couple was to sip from the cup of bitterness when they were forced to face the reality of losing their first child. Marva and Damian tells us their story.
We're in Mexico, and I actually got pregnant. We found out in June that we were expecting. And everything was going perfect until Damian had to go to Jamaica for a missionary trip. So he left, his trip was for, 2 weeks. And I was by myself. And for some reason, I felt as if something was wrong. So I was actually 6 months at the time. And I was admitted in a hospital. Damian was due to come back the week after, but then he had to change the trip and come in the next day. I was in the hospital for how long?
About 2 weeks
when they actually took the baby out, and she was in the incubator for almost 2 weeks as well. Eventually the Lord took her home. It was a very difficult period for both of us.
There wasn't even an ounce of doubt in my mind that everything would work out and the baby would be alive, would have the baby and everything would be fine. And every day we'd go to the hospital, we would look for the baby, we'd pray and we would hold hands and we would sing and we would talk to her and everything. And everything seemed to be going well. And we were still trusting God for the best. And the day came when Marva was released from the hospital and we went to look for the baby and everything was okay. And the doctor came and was giving us pure bad news. She was saying that the heart is not strong, the lungs is not strong enough, not fully developed, and there are going to be some complications, and it's probably that she won't see properly, she won't be able to do anything for herself. And I was just still believing that everything is going to be all right. We left the hospital about 4 o'clock, got home about 4:30. By 5 o'clock or that thereabout, we got a call that we need to come back to the hospital because it seemed as if the baby is going, as if she's going. And I was like, okay. And I called Marva's best friend at the time, told her to pray and stuff. And I didn't even know how to tell Marva what was happening, but I went inside the room. She was in the room getting undressed, went in the room, and I told her that we need to go back to the hospital. And she asked me why. I explained to her the reason. And long and short, we went back to the hospital. She just told us, bam, baby's gone. Marva broke down and started crying. Of course, I started crying because, and even then, I was still believing God for a miracle or something, you know, that should have woken up or something. But there was one scripture that comforted my heart, and it's Romans, I think, 8:20-something, which says, paraphrasing, that nothing happens in your life by chance or by luck. You know, basically, absolutely nothing. And so I took comfort in that scripture, and right through, we're singing this song, "You Are God Alone," and in good times and in bad times, you are always on your throne. And we're singing that song, and we're just believing God and stuff. And I mean, for those 2 weeks, we weren't able to sleep properly at all.
Actually, the day that she passed was the day that I held her. It was at that time her heart rate was slowing down. She was struggling to breathe. So they actually want, I don't know if you've heard of this experiment where they actually put her close to you so she can actually feel the mother and draw some strength from that. So that was the first time they actually opened my blouse and put her on the inside, and she was there. It felt like a little
puppy.
You just saw the little things going up and down, and she was just there. It was, I don't know, that was the best feeling ever. That was the first time I was actually holding my child. And that was for like about two hours she was there.
Here we are expecting our first child, and then our first child is now dead, you know. So I really don't know how to put it in words to actually explain totally how we felt or how I felt. But we are still trusting God for a child, and we still hold firm to that God will bless us with a child. And we also take comfort in that fact.
Wow, words aren't enough. But in times like these, perhaps the advice of counselors can help to process the pain. This week, our counselors tackle a premarital question.
There is life rather in diversity. You might have a spouse who is in the arts, and you find yourself in the sciences. So I say that to say your spouse might be a painter, an artist, a musician, or you might be someone who is in the sciences. Can those two personalities complement each other? Yes, they can. As well as you can find two persons who are in the sciences, who are both medical doctors, who are both farmers, who are both technicians in whatever form. And yes, they can attract, because of the person's attitude towards life. So as a man, yet again, you might find yourself into certain sports, but your wife or your girlfriend is not. That can be a good thing, in the sense that you can talk to your spouse about some of your likes, some of your desires. Talk about, honey, I played the game last night, and I give Damian, in the case might be, six love. Talk to your spouse about the excitement. Let your spouse see the life that is in the activities that you participate in. And that can indeed bring you together, bring a sense of closeness. There are going to be initiatives or activities that both of you enjoy. Do them together. That's where the similarities is a plus. And as I said earlier, where the difference is, it too can be a plus. Should I choose a spouse who complements my personality? And the question really is yes, or the answer to that is really yes. No, the issue of complimenting is not always black and white, as in, I am a talker, then my spouse should be the shy individual. No, not always the case. You will find, though, a good blend where you might have a dominant type personality, an outgoing individual, who's someone who will take charge of a room. And if you are, then your spouse will probably be the individual who works behind the scene. If you find both of you are in an environment where that is the case, and there's no sense of resentment, because oftentimes a shy person might resent the dominant speaker, the outgoing individual, that, oh, that person is getting all the limelight, the glitter, and I feel somewhat awkward. If that's not your case and you are comfortable with your spouse being that individual, then that works well. However, if you find that both of you are, say, dominant in nature in terms of your personality, outgoers, you are loud talkers, you are probably aggressive, you are probably assertive, you are dominant, there are going to be times when, if that's going to be both personalities, some of you have to give and take. Whether you are different in personality from your spouse, or you have similar personality traits, the key thing is that you complement each other. It's not a game of who is more superior than the other. It's not a game of who has more talents than the other, or whose talents are more superior, or whose talent takes more importance or precedence in a relationship. It's never about the issue of more or less, but rather complementing. Whether there are similarities or there are differences, it's about complementing each other.
Ladies, have you ever seen someone where, you know, a couple, and you say, how did those two get together? Or you may say, they just fit so perfectly. They just work well together. They look good. They complement each other. We always find ourselves with those questions. And the only people that can answer those questions for you is a couple themselves. You and only you can know who is right for you. Many times someone may say, I don't see the two of you together. But when you're with that person, it just clicks. It feels right. Sometimes we know how to communicate with somebody really well. But just because you know how to communicate with someone doesn't mean that you are a perfect match for each other. You have to think about not just your personality types. Such, for example, when you think of, I'm a talker and my husband is very quiet. You can look at it and say that, well, I'm a talker and he's a listener. You can say I'm a detail-oriented person and he's someone who has an eye for detail. He sees the big picture. But at the same time, are you such a talker that you're drowning him out, that he never gets a chance to say a word in edgewise? You have to make sure that you complement each other, that those things go hand in hand, that one does not dominate the other or make the other feel weak or inferior. The other thing that's very important, not just communication or how well you click together, is what are your values? To me, that is the most important part. What if your values are different, are very different, then more than no matter how well you communicate or how well you get along with each other, there's going to be trouble down the road. The thing is, suppose I value faith a lot. I like to go to church. I like to be involved in church. And my spouse doesn't believe in God or doesn't feel that I need to be going to Wednesday night and Sunday night meeting or going back to afternoon services. Does that mean that we can click automatically? Maybe it might work. But at the same time, if he resents the amount of time that you're spending in your faith, if he questions your values there, if you are not compatible with your values, it's going to pose a problem. What about something as simple as if you feel you should be out working and your husband expects you to be a stay-at-home mom? Those are two differences there as well that you need to consider. Something like career and family, going back to school, does he expect you to continue to upgrade yourself and at the same time you feel like I'm comfortable right here at home? Another thing you need to look at as well that could cause a problem, even in value systems, is are you someone who likes to spend a lot of money and he likes to keep, a very simple lifestyle? So to me, yes, you want to know that your personalities complement each other, that you're not too different, but sometimes you may admire the differences in the other person. Know this, that once there is too much difference, that there's going to be stress and there's going to be conflict. Remember, differences are a good thing. It keeps the spice in your life, in your marriage. If you all are too in sync, if you have too much in common, then it's going to get boring. So nothing's wrong with a little spice. Know that there are positive attributes that you can love in your partner, even though they may be different. And when there are negatives that may come up, talk to your spouse about it. If that doesn't work, pray about it, and there's always a counselor that you can see.
The average couple would have reached their breaking point after enduring all that Marva and Damian did up to the point of their union. But needless to say, there is nothing average about this couple. Not only have they survived, but they have sustained a successful marriage. Here are a few of their secrets.
I remember that same year when Marva was pregnant, she went to New York and I was home alone for probably about less than a week. And I miss her like crazy, so that companionship, our level of friendship with each other, that is really something I've really grown to appreciate, because I now understand that it's like if she wasn't in my life would be kind of boring somewhat, and as a result after that, I really appreciate her company. I mean, even when she's at work and I'm at home and I'm probably just working and doing stuff, I can't wait for her to come home.
Despite the tumultuous hardship of losing their child, Marva and Damian still remember and celebrate the happy times they had while living in Mexico.
In the first year of our marriage, when we were living in Mexico, we went to out of state to Querétaro. It's by plane, it was like an hour and a half. We spent a weekend there. The place is like Hawaii. It's the Hawaii of Mexico, with a lot of palm trees. Just everything about the place is just romantic. So we did a whole lot of dining, and our favorite thing to do when we go on weekends is to play volleyball on the beach. So we did that all weekend, and we were known as the only black couple down there, playing around with them, and we became like superlatives and stuff. So that was one of our main What was yours?
Fun memories. I would probably have to say, just when we go out and hang out with friends, we had some really neat friends in Mexico who were always encouraging each other. We're always hanging out at each other's house and playing games, and watching Christian movies, and that was really fun for us.
We lift our hats off to the Campbells, a couple that has defied the odds and has survived many challenges in their love story. May their future be full of joy and happiness. Many years to Damian and Marva.